This is the day that the Lord has made. And Lord, we rejoice and we are glad in it. God, I thank you in the weakest moments. God, in the moments that we were completely blinded, you were still there to uphold us, to get us to a point where we recognize you and we see your glory and we see your forgiveness and we see your salvation and we see your peace and we see your joy. God, thank you for getting us there. And thank you for sustaining us while we're right there in it. Every day is your day. In you, Lord, we live, we move, and have our very being. All because of you, Jesus. God, I pray you speak to us tonight. You know our hearts. You know where we all are at the moment. Some are doing good. Some are not so good. Some are give slam out. Some just crawled in here today. Some we're looking forward to tonight. God, whatever is needed up in this place today, we are so glad to be in your sanctuary. And we anticipate what you're going to say. In Jesus' name, everybody up in here says, amen. Yes, Lord. Did you bring your Bible?
Yes.
Well, crack it open. Unleash it. It's living, it's moving, it's breathing, it's active, it's sharp. Have you seen it living in your life? Has it been sharp in your life? How about Philippians 1? You may already have your doodad in there. This is our 10th week being in Philippians, by the way. You ready to get back in it? All right, let's jump in. So we're going to pick up where we left off last week. I didn't tell y'all last week, but I had a whole lot more to say, obviously. I gave you some things that we should pursue if we're searching for the goal. Let me just read it before I get ahead of myself. Philippians 3, verse 14, Paul says this. He says that I press on toward the goal. There's a goal. You're not just pressing on aimlessly into the great nowhere, nothing. There is a goal. He said, I press on towards the goal. Why? For the prize of the upward call. There's a calling God has put on our life in Christ Jesus. Now, that's a heavy, heavy scripture right there. And last week, we went in and we dissected that from one end to the other. But here's what I want you to realize. Every single one of us in here are custom made by God. Do you realize that? You are custom made. There's no one like you. You are who you are because of how God created you and what he's put in you. You are custom made. I love that. Anybody ever had something custom made? Well, you yourself are custom made. It's a beautiful thing. Now, because you're custom made, God has put a calling on your life. He's put an individual calling and an individual purpose for your life. And some of you know what that is, and some of you don't know what that is. And it varies from person to person. You ask God. Some of you know what your passions are. And you use that passion for God's glory. Some are teachers, some preachers, some servers, some givers. Some have other unique ways to minister. That's your calling. That's your purpose. But collectively, when you put all the church together and you put all the custom-made believers together, we also have a collective calling together, okay? A collective goal. And that's what Paul is talking about here, right here in this verse. Every one of us are pressing on to the same goal. The same goal. And that goal is this: Christ likeness. Okay? Don't forget that. Our goal is to be Christ-like, to be like Jesus. Read the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. See every one of those perspectives and what they saw in Jesus and how he reacted and how he taught. Read the Beatitudes, read the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus tells us how we should carry ourselves. This is what our goal is, to look like Jesus. Okay? Now, before you think that there's no way that's possible, listen, let me tell you something. It's possible because the Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of you. So the potential to be Christ-like is there. Now, is it going to happen on this side of heaven? Probably not. But is it possible? Yeah. Yeah, what's in you? Okay, and I know you've got this, you got the Holy Spirit wrapped in flesh, wrapped in an earth suit right now, and it's really, 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 really hard because there's temptations, and there's anger issues, and there's being offended, and there's anxiety, and there's fear, and there's worry, and there's all this stuff. I understand what you're talking about. Let me show you this. Romans, let's go to Romans 8 right quick. Put your bookmark there in Philippians. We're going to be back and forth today. I want you to get this before I jump in it too heavy. Romans chapter 8. Let's look at verse 29. Now, you're in here today. You came. You might as well get your biscuit out and sop it up. Okay? You're here. It's not enough just to be here. And I know it's a victory just to get here. But if you're going to be here, let's sop it up. Y'all know what I'm talking about when I say that, don't you? That ain't just an Arkansas thing. Okay. I mean, you take a biscuit, you can sop up your juice. You can get that honey or the fig preserves. So, amen. You know what I'm talking about. That biscuit's like a sponge. It'll soak that stuff up. See, be the biscuit. Okay. There's a t-shirt, Jamie. Be the biscuit. Okay, here we go. I'm going to explain this to you. I don't want you to be like these big words. I don't want you to be all messed up right here. So it says, for whom he, notice the capital H, for whom Jesus foreknew. Okay, stop right there. You do know that he knew you before you were born. Have you gotten that nailed down yet? You weren't just born and Jesus says, oh, how precious. It wasn't like that. That's us. We do that. No, Jesus, here's what happened. He knew us before we were in our mother's womb. Okay? He thought of us before we were even formed. So he's the one that formed us. He knew us before we were even inside mama. Okay? Before there was even any DNA that started making you up. That God knew you. That ought to blow your socks off right there. Okay, so he knew you, he knew me and you, watch this, he also, watch, here's the big word, people get stirred up over this word, I'm going to explain it to you, he predestined, if he knew you, that means he's got a plan for you, he's got a destiny, that's what that word predestined means, it means before you were even around, alive, he had a destiny for you. Ooh. This is good. Okay, God, well, what was my destiny? To be conformed to the image of his son. Ooh. Oh, wow. What a goal. If you making goals in life, this is your number one goal. Because if you make this your number one goal, then everything else is going to fall where it may. Okay? So what did he do? He predestined us to be conformed, to be like Jesus, to look like Jesus, to be about Jesus. Okay? Now, let me people get stirred up. Let me just finish this. Verse 30. Well, let me just finish the one I'm in. That he might be the firstborn among many brethren. It's talking about now Jesus wouldn't. Jesus is God. He's always been. When it says firstborn, it's talking about in the manger. Okay, he's talking about when Jesus was born, when the Word became flesh. He's talking about he's the firstborn of creation. He's the Savior of the world. He had to come and be flesh, but he always was. Okay? Moreover, verse 30, whom he, here's that word again, predestined. Okay? He's had a destiny for us, right? Before we were born, he also called. He also justified. How did he justify you, church? That's right, by his blood, by that cross, all right? He also glorified. So he's called you, he's predestined you, he's glorified you, he's justified us, he's given us a calling. Now, before you get stirred up on that predestiny stuff, here's what people say. People get all stirred up about that and say, well, God knows, and he predestined this group to go to heaven, and he predestined this group to go to hell. That is not right. Okay, get that out of your head. Here's what he predestined. The cross. The cross was the way, the truth, the life. Jesus making a way that man could be right with God. The way was predestined. Now, him being God, he wants to our destiny to be salvation and be the cross, be the plan, right? Okay. Now, because he's God, he knows the end from the beginning. He knows right now, sadly, and it breaks his heart, how many will not choose him as Lord and Savior? And he knows who will. It's not that he's cutting a group out and saying, well, no matter what you do, you're going to hell. No, 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 no. Does that sound like God? Does that sound like the character of God? Okay, hopefully that clears up some things for you today. Okay? But he knows, sadly, he knows. And here's what he says about it. He says, the road is wide that leads to destruction, and many take that path. And he said, the road is narrow that leads to life, and there's few take that path. Why? Why is it so wide? Because the wide road is a selfish road, is a prideful road. I want to do what I want to do, and there's no surrender. Surrender's the narrow road. Make sense? So here's what I want to tell you. God has predestined us that we should conform to his image. Our goal in life is Christ-likeness. Okay? And in Philippians 1 verse 6, he says, he who began a good work, he started a good work in you. He saved you. He started a good work in you. What did he say? He says, I'm going to finish that thing. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the closer, baby. He's who you bring in the ninth inning. Right? He, when you need three outs, he'll get them outs for you. He is the closer. He finishes. Listen, if he started in you, he's going to see you conform to his image. Isn't that good? Now, this doesn't mean that he's going to swoop down with a Sealy Posturepedic bed with one of them MyPillow pillows laying all around it, because they're the most comfortable things in the world. Okay, with a bed of roses, swoop you up with and petting puppy dogs and take you to heaven. Oh, you know, that's not what he's going to do. Now, Enoch, they said, Enoch walked with God and was no more. He may have got swooped up. Okay, Elijah, chariots of fire, come down, whoop, swooped him up, gone. But it's highly unlikely that's going to happen to us, okay? So quit thinking that, you know, you're almighty and made in the image of God. And oh, it's not that, okay? There still has to be work done, okay? There still has to be some work done. There is a process of becoming the image of Jesus. There's a process of Christ-likeness. I think I could put them on the screen for you. I think I gave them to Jamie back there. I'll just give you these right quick. These are just something that I really live by. I mean, after salvation, there's one thing. If you want to be Christ-like, there's one thing. You better start being obedient to the Holy Spirit's work in you. Okay? That's the first thing. He give you his Spirit to be your comforter, your leader, your guide. You have to take on that and walk by the Spirit of God first and foremost. In that, we surrender. We surrender. At some point, we got to wave the white flag and say, God, I can't do this. You're going to have to do this in me. What did he do when he gathered his disciples? He says, follow me. And every one of them left what they were doing and followed him. I think John the Baptist nailed it when he says, Jesus must become great and I must become less. I must decrease. He must increase. That's Christ-likeness, guys. Who are you wanting to be famous, you or him? Let me tell you something. Jesus being famous can do a whole lot more than you being famous. The next one that I live by, we can no longer be a slave to sin. We can no longer be a slave to sin. Sin can no longer be our master. Do y'all know what it means for sin to be the master over you? When that thing calls, yes, master. That's not good. When anger calls, you step up to the plate. Yes, master. When your addiction calls, you step up to the plate. Yes, master. No longer. No longer because my goal is Christ-likeness, not being a slave and in bondage to my sin. And guys, we're not alone in this. We have God's word. It's a lamp unto our feet. It's a light unto our path. It's like honey on our lips. Isn't that awesome that we have this word? We have all the examples of Jesus. We have the Spirit's conviction. Listen, he's your invoice. We have a voice inside of us that will lead you into the right path. And then the next thing is spiritual growth. You have to be growing. Paul talks about it, growing in grace and knowledge, growing in love towards one another. Are you growing in love towards one another? That's one thing he asks us to do. And our passion, let me ask you something. As the older you get, is your passion for Jesus getting stronger or is it getting weaker? Because here's the thing, we talked about this last week. Apathy can set in when you think you have arrived. And when you think you have arrived, apathy can set in and you become insensitive. I don't know about you. I said this last week. I don't want to be insensitive. I don't want to be insensitive. What's the Lord's going to do? Let me show you one more. 2 Corinthians, your Romans go right. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Let me show you this one. We're going to get into it in just a second. Are you following me so far? Our goal, we have a goal in life, and that is Christ-likeness. If you don't know what that means, then you need to go read what Christ looks like, how he acts, how he carries himself. We need to know this because we just found out that our destiny, that our goal is to be like him. Not your neighbor, all right? Not anybody, Jesus, okay? All right, go with me in this one, 2 Corinthians 3. I'm going to start in verse 12. Paul's talking about we have such a hope. What a hope we have, y'all. Watch verse 13, though. And picture this. It says, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. Now, let me stop there. You may have no idea what he's talking about there. Go back to Old Testament in your mind. Moses led the children of Israel through the power of God across through the Red Sea. They're in the wilderness. It's time for Moses to go up on the mountain and meet with God. This is where he gets the Ten Commandments. But while he's up there, he's fellowshipping with God. He's having prayer time with God. And he asks God, he says, God, show me your glory. You ever gotten that close to the Lord in prayer that you just said, Lord, show me your glory. Show me your awesomeness. Show me the manifestation of who you are. Turn yourself inside out, God, and show me who you are. That's what he's saying. God says, well, I'd like to, but I can't. Here's why. I've created you to live on earth for right now, and you're in an earth suit. And if you're in an earth suit, we cannot, in an earth suit, contain the glory of God. So when he says, show me your glory, and if God says, yeah, I'll show you my glory, he did. You understand? So here's what God says. He says, I'll just give you a little bit of my exhaust fumes. So he hit him in the cleft of the rock, kind of hit him, and God came by, but God covered him with his hand, so because he couldn't see the glory of God, right? And as he swooshed by, you ever draw a picture and write little swishes on there? Like movement, you know? The exhaust fumes of God going by, Moses took a little peep. Like that. God kind of let him see just a little bit, right? And all of a sudden, his face shined like an LED light. I mean, he became like a glow worm, you know? He was shining. Why? Because he got a teeny tiny bit of the unapproachable light of God. Okay, awesome. He spent a lot more time with God. So then he comes down the mountain. Glory of God all over him, right? Enough, that's about all he could stand. He comes down the mountain where he's around the people. Before he got there, he put a veil over his face. He covered his head because he knew that the people could not handle the glory of God. Okay, think about how sad that is for a minute. You cover yourself because people can't handle God in you? Okay, you see what we're talking about here. So he makes that in verse 13. Paul's talking about that. He says, unlike Moses who veiled his face because he didn't want the children of Israel to look at him, now the whole time that he starts hanging around the people, he starts fading. Think about it. The more you hang around sin, the glory of God will fade. That's why it's tough. Come by Tuesday. You did good on Monday. But Tuesday, and that's why you're here tonight. Show me your glory, Lord. Right? Verse 14, it says, talking about children of Israel, their minds were blinded. Now watch this. For until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament because the veil is taken away in Christ. Now, let me explain this to you. I know this is heavy scripture. To this day, the Jewish nation, those that don't believe in Jesus, they'll stand up in church during the synagogue and they read the scrolls with no power. Nothing there. Because they don't believe in Jesus. Therefore, they continually be failed. But it just says that it's Jesus Christ who rips the veil away. Because it is finished. God is now with man. He has made a way. Isn't that good? He's made a way. Verse 16, nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Isn't that good? When we finally give our hearts to Jesus, it's like you can see everything. You're no longer veiled by sin. You're no longer veiled by the bondage of this world. And it says in verse 17, now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit is, there is freedom. There is liberty where the Spirit of the Lord is. Does anybody know that yet? Has the Spirit of God set you free? No? Okay. Here's what I want to get to. Verse 18. But we all, believers, with an unveiled face, we're looking in a mirror and see the glory of the Lord. Wait a minute. Wait. You're telling me, as stinky, nasty sinner who I really used to be, I can now look in the mirror and see the glory of the Lord? How ridiculous does that sound? Well, it sounds ridiculous because it ain't about us. It's all about the work of Jesus Christ in us. And that's why he says, you're looking in the mirror, you see the glory of the Lord. Why? Because you're being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. That's why
with unveiled face, you can see who you're supposed to be. If you want to know who you're supposed to be, look at Jesus. Guys, one day this will happen. We're going to be like Jesus. But until then, we got to forget the past. We got to press on. We got to fight. We got to run to reach the goal. Quit being consumed with ourself. And when you're consumed with your needs and you're consumed with your comfort, you will rarely do anything for Jesus. Rarely do anything for Jesus. Now, let's go back to Philippians. We are, by the way, for those of you that haven't been here, we're in a study of Philippians. We've been going verse by verse, and we've ended up in 3. Last week, we studied verse 12 through 16. Tonight, we're going to study verses 17 through 21. Last week, I gave you 5 things that we needed to do to be like Jesus, to be more like Jesus. I'll give them to you again right quick, because the next 3 I'm going to give you go with these first 5, so there'll be 8 in total. We actually started discussing these in Sunday school, by the way. But anyway, here we go. Let me just run through them again. And we learned this, and any of this you want to know, verses 12 through 16, you'll find these things. The first one that we see is awareness. Church, we have to be aware that we have not arrived yet. We have to be aware of our spiritual condition. You have to be aware of that. Now, since you're aware of that and you know you're not where you should be yet, then there's one thing that we need to do, and he says press on, which is max effort. So number 1, awareness. Number 2 is max effort. We give max effort. We press on. We give all we got. No half-stepping, right? Now, max effort, just in that is not enough. Then you have to have concentration. You have to have focus. Because then that's when he says you got to forget what lies behind. You got to forget what's in your past. Listen, you cannot look backwards and effectively go forward. You're going to be sharing your focus, and a divided house will fall. Okay? So concentration, focus, and that'd be the third one. The next one is motivation. To me, the motivation here is easy, because one day we will stand before Jesus Christ, the one who took the nails, so we could be redeemed. What could be more motivating than that, to know that one day we are going to be face to face? We're going to get to grab his hand and rub on the holes in his hand and see his feet and his side and the scars, what he went through to get ugly for us. And then he's going to ask, what have we done since salvation? Whoo, that should motivate you. Because listen, this is not a day that you can call in sick. This is not a day that you're going to miss. You will be there. Okay? And it can be awesome where he looks at you and he says, well done, my good and faithful servant. What a beautiful thing. This could be the day that you receive the crown of life that you give right back to him, because we don't deserve anything. And the fifth one was this: keeping the standard, keeping the word of God. If we're going to pursue Jesus Christ and in his image, we must keep his word, because his will is his word. Okay? So, 3 more tonight, and I'll show them to you as we get there. Verse 17. Everybody go back. Everybody there? Am I going too fast? Okay. I get fired up. I got so much to share, but y'all know it ain't your first time here. Okay. All right, let's just start right here. Okay. Remember, Paul is writing this from prison. This is why we're calling this the snowball effect. Paul, this is in a positive way, he was a bad man, didn't know Jesus. His life was changed, and he's a snowball running downhill, affecting everybody, getting bigger and bigger, planting churches, preaching the gospel. It was a positive snowball effect. And it's the same thing in our life. God saved you, redeemed you. You start that little bit of snowball, you're rolling. You're rolling now. What kind of effect are you going to have? So here Paul is in prison. He doesn't know if he's going to live or die. So he's writing these letters to these churches, and he's saying, guys, listen to me. Listen to me. This information I'm giving you is so valuable.
So when you read this, think about it. He could be, if he was up here today, he'd be crying and bawling. He'd say, guys, listen to me. This is so important. You don't read it just, no, you read it. It's real. Amen? Okay. Brethren, join in following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. Instead of reading all of it, I'm just going to go verse by verse right here. Okay. Now listen to me. Here's the first one I want to show you right here. Right out of verse 17. This would be the 6th of the 8. This is so important because you realize that you haven't arrived, therefore you still look for good examples. Okay? Following after good examples will help us get to where we need to be, our destinies, which is Christ-like. Now, when I say good examples, obviously Paul starts off and says, hey, guys, follow my example. But here's what you got to realize, because when you read that, you can think, oh, he's got the big head already. He's been saved for a while. He's planting churches. Now he's got the big head. That's not what he's saying at all. He is not putting himself on a pedestal. He says in some of his writings that he says, I'm the worst of the sinners. So understand that he's humble. No, here's what he's saying. He is saying, and if you notice in his writings, he's very transparent, and he will tell you his failures. He tells us his failures up front. Man, I failed. But here's what's greater than that, what you see in Paul's writings. Paul gives you the failures, but he stresses how he overcome those failures. Okay? That's the key right there. How did he overcome? You know, we read these verses by Paul. He talks about, why do I do what I don't want to do and what my body doesn't want to do? He's like, I beat my body in this body of death. And he gets so sick of fighting with sin. And he goes on and he encourages us how to overcome that. I love a man. I love a woman that will be real. Be real with you. I love that. That's how Paul is. And guys, I think it's wonderful how God uses Paul here. But notice what else he says, though. And this is where you got to assess those that you're around. He says, I want you to note those who so walk. In other words, those that you can pattern your life after. Now, assess real quick those people in your life. Some of those people may be dead now. But you still need to look to those examples. Our Bible is full of examples that can lead us in the right way. Think about it. And here's what I'm talking about. And I know how our minds go. We think, okay, who's perfect in my life that I can follow their example? That's not what I'm talking about. Okay? Listen. Following someone that's perfect is not going to help you. Listen. We need to know people that has overcome imperfections. They know how to handle struggles and trials and adversities and disappointments. They know how to handle pride. They know how to handle temptation. They don't know how to handle anger. They know how to overcome these things. Somebody that's real with you. Because here's what you can do. You can go to them and they say, yeah, this is the way I used to be, but look what God's done in my life and look where I'm at now. I want to own the job training folks. Okay? That can walk you through. Yeah, I've been right there with you. That's why Jesus says, I can sympathize with all of your weaknesses. He does. He says, I can sympathize. I've been there. I know. I was thinking about the other day, I was fishing. And you know, guys that fish, you know what I'm talking about. When you get a backlash, throw an open face reel, you get backlashes. Everybody gets backlashes. Don't lie and say you don't. That's what I'm getting at. Then you got somebody over there fishing, you know, around you. You do this. You're like, You don't want anybody to see that you got a backlash. They say, man, he's terrible. He can't fish. The other day, I'm fishing. I done had 2 or 3 backlashes, right? And I saw the guy right over there doing this. I said, that's what I'm talking about. That's my kind of guy right there.
he gets backlashes too. You need to realize other people get backlashes too. Jesus knows what it means to have a backlash, and he can tell us how to get it out. I hope that makes sense. Now, example. Let's take the word example. Okay, it's a pattern. My grandpa, he used to build houses, and I remember he would cut one board perfectly, and he'd say, "All right, son." He's like, "Cut me 20 more. Look just like this." And what would I do? I would take that same board. I would put it up there. Whoosh, whoosh, skill saw. Whoosh, 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 whoosh. Why? Because I had a pattern to go by. You ever trace something? Right? That's a pattern. That's a pattern. This is what an example is. When you're looking for an example, you're looking for something to pattern your life after. Now check this out. Let's go a little bit deeper in this. The Greek meaning of example is this. Don't miss this. Okay? It means a mark left by a hard blow. Oh, that's good right there. A mark that's left on something that's took a hard blow. It's a mark. It's a mark left when something made a massive impact. I never forget my grandpa. We wasn't around horses a whole lot, but every time we'd get around one, he said, "Boy, don't walk behind that horse. Don't walk behind that horse." He got kicked as a kid right in the head. And he said, "I ain't never," that impact made a mark on him, right? He's like, "I'm never walking back." And he would share it with us, all us kids, like, "Don't walk behind that horse. That horse kicked the fire out of you. I've seen him do it too. It's not good." But think about it. Think about your life and what blows you have taken to mark you in a good way. I mean, we're talking about good examples. I'm not talking about bad examples yet. I'm talking about good examples. What has left a mark on you? Some of you that's been in houses or you've had something for a long time, it's probably scarred up. You can remember why and where those marks come from. And you can remember the situation where those marks come from. This is what I'm talking about. Who has marked you? Who has left a mark on you in a good way? Those are the ones that you pattern your life after. Another meaning of example means something that's stained or something that's dyed, D-Y, dyed, not died, dead, okay? Think about it. Think about your life. Let's flip this around for a minute. What if it's your turn to be the example? What if it's your turn to be the example? Who are you staining in a good way? Anybody ever got something that just had just plain wood and you put some stain on it? Okay, same thing. Are you staining your kids? Are you staining your grandkids for the glory of God? Because those are some marks that can be left that will last forever. Now, think about this for a minute. Because some of you in here, you worried now about the stains that you left in a negative way, or the stains that's been left on you. Let me encourage you right quick with something. This is out of Ephesians 5, 25, 26, 27. I want you to listen to this. So if you're in here today and you've been stained by your past, maybe it wasn't even your fault. You've been scarred by your past. You look in a spirit realm. I mean, you've got some cuts and bruises. Well, here's what God says. Watch this. He makes an example here in Ephesians 5:25. He says, and I love this because this works in marriage too. Husbands, love your wife. How? Just like Jesus loves the church. Now, just pause there for a minute on that one. Okay, husband, are you loving your wife like Jesus loves us? Because we're the church. Wow. Okay, what did he do? He gave himself up for her. This is where if you write in your Bible, you can write unconditional love. That's agape love, unconditional love. He gave it all, right? He gave it all for us, okay? But watch this. Why? That he might sanctify, that means set apart, and cleanse her, how? With the washing of the water by the word. Church family, listen to me right quick. We're wanting to be Christ-like, right?
The starting of that, he's got to set us apart from who we used to be. Then to get us clean, he starts washing us by the water of the word. Okay? You ever had one of them things, you stick in your soap and it sucks through your water hose? Or maybe some, no, I can't use poison. You know how you poison, my aunt poison, or I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about soap, something that cleanses. Okay? Think of God sticking that hose down in the living water and standing there washing you like they do in prison. No, he doesn't wash you that hard. He washes you gentle. It's like I can see him dipping in his living water and easily wiping that off of you. Your past, your guilt, your shame, cleaning you all up. Listen, sometimes that's uncomfortable, but every single one of us right here tonight are being washed by the word. How does it feel? Feels good, doesn't it? To be washed by the word. What is he doing? He's cleaning us. But watch this. Here's why. Here's why he's cleaning you. What is our goal, church? Christ-likeness. Okay? Somehow we got to get from where we are, where we were. Look where we at right now. Be encouraged. Look how far you've come. Okay? So look where you at right now. Okay? And look how far you got to go. Okay? How's he going to get you there? He's washing you by the word. But wait a minute, now we're going to see what we're going to look like. You ready? That he might present her, us, we are his bride, himself, a what? Glorious church. Watch this, not having, what is spots? Stains, flaws, scars. Think about an old goat with 1-3 legs, you know? That's a spot. What's a wrinkle? Well, it's when you ain't ironed your clothes. I don't iron them either. I don't even know how to iron. But anyway, I don't even know why I said that. I guess I could. I'd burn a hole in it. I don't care if it's wrinkled or not. I don't really. God doesn't want you wrinkled, though. Because when there's a wrinkle, there's an inconsistency. There's something that you ain't sure about. He doesn't want scars. He doesn't want wrinkles. He doesn't want stains from your past. He doesn't want any of that on you. That's why he's washing you in the water of the word, because you're going to be Christ-like. He's wanting you to look like him, church family. Do you see that? So instead of squirming and wiggling and complaining and fussing, just let him wash you. He's already put you in the wash bin. If you're saved, he's already put you. He set you apart to wash you. Let him wash you. And don't think you're done washing. He just switching wash rags. Okay. Okay. Man, this is... Okay, number one, good examples. Find good examples. Man, we're already out of time. Okay. Here's the next one. We got to flee bad examples. Flee bad examples. Go back to Philippians 3. My. Here we go. Many walk, verse 18, of whom I have told you often, and now I tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Jesus Christ. How? How could you be an enemy of the way that makes you right with God? I did. I wrote that in my Bible right there. How? Big question mark. Well, here's how. Look at verse 19. Instead of their end being Christ-like, what is their end? Destruction. Now, here's the key to why they're like they are. Whose God is their what? Belly. Now, if you write in your Bible, write appetite right there. Appetite. And whose glory is in their shame. Do you remember bragging on what you used to do? I drank you under the table. Look what I did. I knocked their teeth out. You know, well, I was with that girl, and then
this girl later on that night, you know? I mean, what? Did we brag on that stuff? I mean, what? You see what I'm saying? We're bragging on our shame. It's who we used to be. Watch this. Who set their mind on what? Earthly things. Okay. These church are bad examples that can hinder our goal of Christ-likeness. You hang around people whose God is in their belly. You're hanging around people whose appetite does not include Jesus. Even if their appetite, they want a little bit of Jesus. If their main course is not Jesus, that's not a good example. See, a person whose appetite doesn't include Jesus, they're capable of anything. And here's what we'll do. It will create a pattern that will sink those who look up to them. I don't know why this sticks in my head. We were at a Rangers game years ago, and there's a beautiful family sitting there in front of it, mom, dad, two or three kids or whatever. And here come the beer man up the aisle. Hey, whatever he's hollering, you know. And you see, I see that they're sitting around, the dad does this, you know, or whatever, two, one or two, whatever. And instead of walking back over behind and hands them to the kids. Hands them to the kids to pass them down. And them kids are just looking at this. And they want to hold it like this. You know, daddy's saying, you know, stop it. What are you showing your kids? What are you showing? You're showing your kids it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. That's a bad example. You may crucify me over that. It's a bad example. They already, them 10-year-old kids are holding it like they wanted it. Oh, like, the, you know what I'm saying? Why? They've been seeing it. They've been seeing it. And what do you think they're going to do the first time they're outside of the house and they have an opportunity and their friend go, whoop, they're going to hit it. What if it's going to be something a little heavier, a little worse? They're probably going to try it. They're going to hit it. That's how it happens. You got to be a better example of that. You create a pattern. You create a pattern in your home that will sink your kids. Mom and daddy fussing and fighting all the time, you're creating a pattern that will sink your family. What do you think they're going to do? We should be teaching them how to be mamas, daddies, how to be husband, wives, how to be friends, how to be nice, how to speak to people, how to honor people, how to respect people, how to go to church. Instead of setting other patterns. Let me give you this example, and I hate to, but I'll have to stop. I will give you the third one, though, just so you can take it with you. Jonah. Think about Jonah just for a second. Jonah, God says, hey, Jonah, I want you to go preach to those in Nineveh. They are acting a fool. They're full of sin. I need to send my preacher, my prophet, my man of God to that city. Jonah looked at him and says, no. Yeah, there's no way I'm going. So he jumps on a ship that's going totally the opposite way. If you look at the map, he's running from God. So he jumps on a ship full of mariners, and they go back and forth for a while, and all of a sudden God says, I'm going to get his attention. So he sends a hurricane force wind up on that ship. Now, let me ask you this. Who is God after? Jonah, okay? There are mariners on the ship that did not reject God and do what Jonah did. But if Jonah's in a hurricane and you're with Jonah in a hurricane, you're in a hurricane. Okay? You follow me? So they get to talking back and forth, back and forth. They find out that Jonah is the problem. They start paddling. Trying to do things in their own way. It never does work. Here's what they had to do. They had a problem on their boat. And y'all know the story. They threw him out of the boat. And the moment they got the problem out of the boat, what happened to the sea? Calm. Calm. Why? Because the problem was gone. Okay. I want you to think right now. Who do you have in your boat that's causing you to nearly sink? Or what kind of influence? Yeah. Or what kind of habit, what kind of stronghold, what kind of attitude is in your life that's about to sink you? What have you patterned yourself after that is about to sink you? What we can learn from the book of Jonah, chapter 1, is we got to get that where? Out of the boat. These are bad examples. We can't pattern ourselves after that. We will sink. We will sink. Let me read this to you right quick. Matthew 15, verses 13 and 14. And we'll wrap it up. Listen to this. Jesus says this. Matthew 15, verse 13 and 14. He said, every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Listen, God does not plant anything evil. Okay? If a man is evil, he chose that. Okay? He doesn't plant evil. Okay? If the enemy plants it, it will be uprooted. Watch this, verse 14. Let them alone. Somebody needs to hear this right now. Let them alone. Or let that alone. Something that God has not planted in your life, let it alone. What did you tell that dog? I used to train it in my labs. I said, leave it. You know, when he would bring the duck back, and oh man, he's just so happy. He'd tear my duck up. Leave it. Leave it. Right? God is telling you to leave it. Leave it. Watch this. They are blind, leaders of the blind. And if the blind leads the blind, both will fall into the ditch. And what can you do in the ditch? Call a tow truck. That's all you can do. That's when you call in the strong arm. The Lord will come in and he will pull you out. But there's so many people in the ditch right now because they have patterned themselves after a bad example, which will hinder us being Christ-like. This is the negative snowball effect in our life. Guys, I have much more to say, but I'm going to just tell you this, and we'll close right down. The third one is this, or it'll be the eighth one, to focus on the kingdom. To focus on the kingdom. To focus on the kingdom. Listen, the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is God's way of doing things. You know the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We can have God's will done. There, we can be a kingdom man. We can be a kingdom woman. We can have a kingdom marriage. We can have a kingdom family. We can have a kingdom church. We can have kingdom leadership. What does that mean? If we're in and under the will of God, that's where our focus needs to be, which will head us towards Christ-likeness. But we'll stop right there. I honestly hate to. I don't know how time goes by. And you may be thinking, oh my goodness, thank you. I'm glad he's done. But anyway, that's where we are. I'm really trying to do better on my time. So we'll stop right there. Guys, I hope you can get a hold of what we're talking about and what our goal is. Some of us may need to change goals. Maybe we need to sit down and review our goals. Our number one goal, Christ-like. Seeking first his kingdom, and then everything else will be added. Everything else that we need. Amen?
Amen?
All right. Well, let's stop right there, and we'll go to the Lord in prayer. And we'll get home. Some of you need to eat. Some of you need to rest. Some of you need to shower. And your neighbor said, amen. No.